Welcome everyone. I'm pleasure to invite Dr. Sanjeev, who is a famous pediatrician based out of Bangalore and a very avid wildlife photographer himself. I think this session is going to give you extreme insights about how he does wildlife photography, how he has been into this field. So please do stay tuned toward till the end, and I'm sure you will learn a lot. Good morning, Sanjeev.
Very good morning, and namaskara.
Namaskara. If with your permission, Sanjeev, shall I go ahead with my questions?
Please do so.
Great. It's good to see your smiling face, Sanjeev. Let me tell you that.
You too.
Right.
That is what is left with us right now.
Absolutely. So I think
keep smiling.
Since you are a doctor and yes. You were telling me the other day that how this pandemic has created fear. I am sure you deal with this every day and night for last six odd months.
Yes.
Has it been very stressful?
Not exactly. If I don't work, it is stressful.
So if I
don't go in wild, it is stressful.
Right. I was going to say that, so some of us do say that if I don't click something in a day, I get mad.
Yes.
Okay. So Sanjeev, my first question to you is, how did you come to love photography? Were there any early influences in your life?
Yeah, though I would say my first prerana, my inspiration was my daughter. Some 20 years back, so around 18 years back, when she was just 3 years old. We used to stay in a place called Sevagram in Maharashtra, which is in Wardha, and it's surrounded by three rivers, and it's sort of an island. So you have plenty of plants and birds there, and she was always fascinated looking at them. And when I used to put on the TV, she used to cling to Animal Planet and Nat Geo instead of going to see the Cartoon Network, which kids that age would do. And this sort of her interest pulled me into. Then we got some small books about birds, and slowly it increased and increased, and we very, very rapidly we went to graduate to the bird books. And this is how slowly we started doing our outings into the wild with my daughter when she was just 3 years old, and it's still continuing.
Right.
A family which is interested in nature is a big motivation.
Right.
And then once you start looking at things, the more you know, the more you find the things in it. The wild around your house also. So this is how it kept on increasing over a period of time.
Right. So I think is a big influencer. I agree, because those who are, from the nature, if your entire family is into, love with nature, there's nothing like it.
Yes. Even my wife, she's also a radiologist. She's a doctor, and she's an avid nature lover. And she works for some conservation also, but she's more busy than me. So nowadays she doesn't have time. And when we go, all three of us, when we go in last 10 years back, my friend said, why don't you document? We are moving around in jungle so much. We just had those days point and shoot. Then we shifted to the DSLR systems. And all three of us have our own gadgets. And we go out, we document. And this is how 10 years back, we started the wildlife photography. And practically our outing is never into a movie or a movie hall or into a mall. We always go into wild. Either we are working, and if we are not in Bangalore, we are in jungle.
So then on the lighter note, I should say that, nature is your spa.
Yes. Mother Nature is the best de-stressor and the spa.
Right. And what beautiful would it be that if your entire family is with you, nothing like
yes,
that.
Yes. A family support is badly needed for a wildlife photographer as such, because the gadgets are costly and your family has to agree and cooperate with you. That is very, very important. Fortunately, I am very, very, very happy to have a family which itself, it's all of us, we are into photography and we all understand that.
Wow, wonderful. Okay, my next question to you, Sanjeev, would be, would you call yourself a wildlife photographer only, or are there other genres of photography that you also practice?
No. I'm very bad at photographing Homo sapiens.
Okay.
I tried a little bit with landscape. No, very difficult. I am a wildlife photographer, primarily birds, then mammals. My love is lesser mammals, not the general, everybody goes for tigers. I do that. But I love to go for lesser mammals, and then macro, definitely. I love doing macro. This is a season of macro, right?
Right.
No other genre of macro. photography.
But have you tried them or?
Somehow I tried to try, but but I got tired of trying. So okay. I didn't like it at all. Somehow that my wavelength didn't match those genres. So I'm very happy with my wildlife, my animals, and I love that. Sometimes what happens is you have to be a wildlife lover to be a wildlife photographer.
Right, right.
There have been sessions when some bird comes in front of me or animal comes off me. I forget clicking. I keep watching it. I get mesmerized. So if till one, you have to have that much of commitment or liking for that genre, and then only you can photograph. Other systems, other departments, I'm not comfortable to that extent. So it doesn't happen.
Right. I guess it's like in your profession that if you're a pediatrician, you know, you better be subject matter expert.
Yes. You send me an adult, it's impossible for me to see.
Correct.
Something like that.
But you know, and I think there's nothing wrong in it, you know, because if what you love, you should click.
It's sure. All your individual. I'm really sometimes motivated to see people doing photography, different kinds, and in wildlife also there are so many specific photographies you are doing. For example, I will give you a small example of macro photography. A lot of people do macro photography, but I do wet macro photography. Now, what does that mean? I go when it rains badly. I look for frogs. I look for snakes and all those creatures which are wet. It's very difficult. We have to do all the night. We have to do photography. But there are people who do very good dry photography. Now, what does that mean? They go for insects. They go for butterflies. That is a difference. I don't do that. So everybody has his own way of doing it, own liking. So what likes you should do. Absolutely. Then only you will come out with the best.
Correct. I agree. Right. So my next question then for you, Sanjeev, is so what inspires you to keep pursuing photography? Because, you know, I'm sure you're so busy with your, with a profession, that do you really find time, and what is that inspiration?
See, there's a saying, is finding time is a culture. We should be motivated. If there is a will, there is a way. I know, as I told you, we always work. What does that mean? We work on Saturday also. We work on Sunday also. Right. So we never have a free time, and then we work in the day also, we work in the night also. The calls can come anytime, the deliveries can happen anytime, the emergencies can come anytime, we have to attend them. So we have to be always on our toes. Now, what does that mean? Does this mean that we don't have time? No, we have plenty of time. If there is, when we don't work, means we are in jungle. So then we have to develop a system. I have my colleagues who support me. So when I am not there, they cover me. So you have to build, you have to have a system which helps you. And when you are interested so much, the system over a period of time falls in place. Everybody has time. What we need to understand is making time is culture. We should make it. We will definitely be able to do better. And actually being occupied always, you're never busy. When I'm sitting lazy, I don't feel like doing anything. So if you are busy, you always have time.
I agree. And I think
so-called time management, as we say, time management is the biggest thing. And as I said, when we go out, I mingle with my family when I go out from my home. We are so busy, everybody. We don't have time. So we spend quality time with each other when we go for photography. So this is the way we have a family time also and a photography time also.
Wonderful. You know, I think I 200% agree with you, because there are a lot of people who keep telling me that, how did you do this? I don't have time kind of stuff. So for example, sun rises every day and sun rises sets every day.
Yes.
But if you see, you don't need a camera to actually see that, the sunrise every day is dramatic. There are different, things that happen.
There's a saying only, no sunset is same and no sunrise is same.
Correct.
So you're standing at the same point every day, you're looking at it. None of these sunrises and sunsets are same. There are different hues of the same color. So, and there is so much difference every time. So, as you said, yes, you should have time to do that. And then you said, what pursues me? So, around eight years back, I took one training, which is called as Naturalist Training Program, which is conducted by JLR and one very good guru. We call him Guruji. If you know Karthikeyan, he is the chief naturalist in JLR, and he is the one who motivated us to understand nature. After that training, we got too much of knowledge about the behavior. And the more you know, the more you are addicted into nature. The more it sucks you. So once you get more knowledge about behavior, you feel like going and understanding it more. So that is the way I even more improved on my photography, as well as understanding. And that increased the interest of going into the jungles.
Right. Wonderful.
Just carrying the camera and going to shoot an animal will not help you. If you have a knowledge of behavior, you can come out with wonderful results.
Right. I think that's a very important point for all our audiences to also know, you know, because just carrying a camera and, you know, it is easy to keep clicking, but then you need to understand
yes, yes.
the subject. No. No, you need
to. Very, very important. And my fortunate was it happened in a way that first 10 years I didn't shoot. I tried to see them. Next 10 years I have been shooting. So it gave me a little more understanding and edge. So always try to understand, read about them, understand the behavior, understand from the people who know it. And then you go, you will come back with better results.
Right. Great. So my next question to you, Sanjeev, is how do you feel, you know, when your work is viewed and appreciated by a very large audience?
Who doesn't like that? Why? If anything is getting appreciated, everybody likes that, isn't it? So it's right. always good. Now, when you put it in an audience, and there are two things. One thing is you learn from them. They will always tell them, see, this is that. This is you have some feedbacks. You have some criticisms. You always try to improve over those things if you take it positively. And then you make more new friends. You improve your network. You understand. You get more knowledge about what is happening. Some people will give you some more knowledge. And then you can share your knowledge also with them. And that helps over a long period of time. More people develop love for nature, the conservation efforts will be better. So it's always better that more and more people understand nature, click nature. So that helps overall for the planet, for the Mother Earth.
Right, right. I think that's a very critical message as well, you know, because unless you do things, you know, especially in nature and wildlife, I would say, that, you know, people will not understand, you know, the ramifications that it will have in future, for especially for our children and, you know, your future generations. So I think
definitely
critical. This thing. Great. I know I have probably, you know, asked this question in parts earlier, but I just still want to know, you know, so the wildlife photography that you do, you know, since you are so busy, you know, you said even on the weekends, you sometimes are working, you know, because you are in a profession where there is no, it's not time bound. It's a kind of a job, you know, I'm sure you get emergencies, you have to attend and all that. And considering that you are a pediatrician, naturally, it's even more, because you're dealing with children. So, you know, it is even more critical, you know, that you immediately look at them. But considering all that, you know, you still find time, but is it something like, you know, you plan for, you know, these outings in the nature, or you just walk up one day and say, okay, let's go?
No, it's not like that. It has to be planned and it has to be unplanned also. See, always remember, if you plan too much and go for an outing, you will come back with some, you will not be very happy sometimes. And sometimes you just go and unplanned trips sometimes are more rewarding. So there's nothing like plan in wildlife. Yes, we have to plan in a way that we'll have to look at the times. There are some seasons where we have a lot of viral outbreaks or diseases. Those days we really don't go out anywhere. We have to attend to our work. So that will always be a priority. So we attend to our work, and there are some seasons like when the kids' schools are closed and they go home and they don't fall sick much. Well, April, for example, I always keep April, May. I go overseas those months. So it has to be planned. And there are some seasons where some sightings happen. For example, if you have to shoot a migratory bird, you have to plan it in winter. Similarly, if you have to see a snow leopard, you have to go in winters, in the, when the temperatures are really low, minus 30, minus 40, when they descend down to those altitudes where we can reach. So it's always like that. If you have to if you have to do a macro right now, it's badly raining and then only the view, you can see frogs. So some things have to be planned season-wise. Sometimes you will suddenly get information that for such and such sightings are happening in such and such place. So we have to sometimes adjust with our colleagues and we have to go. So both the ways it is, but majority of the times it's more planned. You have to plan and go. You cannot go because unfortunately, wildlife photography worldwide is very expensive. Particularly right. Those who do tiger photography, they will understand. You have to book well in advance your safaris, your zones, your jeeps. So it is not an easy task. You can just not lift your camera and just walk into any jungle. It's very difficult nowadays. There are so many people who want to go and see the wildlife. So you have to book it well in advance. It's more like a railway railway booking nowadays, the bookings open in parks like Corbett and all and closes within 15 minutes, everything is over. So a lot of planning has to go if you want to do all those things. Some are planned, some are unplanned, both ways. But yeah, we have to manage a lot of things. And I was actually a professor in a medical college. I was a teaching faculty for 15 years in pediatrics department. And after the teaching hours, after 4 o'clock, I used to practice in the private hospital. Now, it was very difficult to take holidays in a college where you have a big team and you have your own unit and postgraduate teachings, undergraduate teachings, everything is happening. So I had to quit the job. So I quit the job of professorship just for this passion. And now I am doing full-time private practice. I have two colleagues who cover me when I am not there. So this is the way you have to arrange it and you have to go for your outings. It has to be arranged. You have to have plannings for everything. You have to sometimes sacrifice also a few things.
Correct. I agree. I think... All in all, as long as you are connected with your profession and your passion, I think
that's more. Yes. You have to balance.
You have to balance. Yes, exactly.
World, as we say, work, wildlife balance.
Nice. First time I am hearing. I've always heard.
For me, it is like balance. That.
Right. Okay.
So as we always say, you party, you work hard and you party hard. It's for me, it's work hard and wildlife hard. So it's like that. So it's your passion. You have passion, you'll always generate your time, your planning, everything comes, falls in place automatically.
I think a very important word that you use, that work hard, wildlife hard. You know, it's very, yeah. I think it's a new mantra in itself.
Yeah, for us, we don't party the way people party. For us, right. That is the party. A wildlife party is a party for us.
Yeah, and like I said, if it's a natural spa, nothing like it.
Nothing like that. Yeah. So much oxygen we breathe and come back.
Correct. Today people want artificial oxygen, you know, because of the pandemic.
Half of our patients are on artificial oxygen. We all know that. So those people who have been connected to nature are doing well. The tribals, if they get COVID, are not going to fall as sick as a villager. And a villager is not going to fall as sick as a person who is an urbanite. It's very clear here. Because our lungs have already got damaged because of the pollution and other things. So we don't have the reserve the lung requires as compared to a tribal or a villager. So we need to understand why Mother Nature is so important for our survival, for our individual survival. Materialistic world is not everything in life.
Right. Wonderful. So Sanjeev, next question would be, you know, can you share some of your achievements in photography profession?
You heard what I said. Work and click. This has been my mantra for less. I really sometimes don't even get time to open my folders to see what I clicked. And whenever I get time, I definitely open, process and put them. I have never got time to arrange an exhibition or to attend a competition or a salon. So I have never been. I have a huge collection. All my friends who started photography after me have achieved so many laurels in this field. But I have always been clicking and not going for all these things. Maybe in future, let me see if I can do. My only achievement is whenever I get time, I am in the wild and I click.
Wonderful. Yeah, I mean, that's perfectly fine too. You know, you don't need to participate in salons only to be recognized.
Somehow, I have never been into that mode. Some people are very aggressive into participation and and they go to a very competitive extent, and that is very good also. So that always improves you. A good, healthy competition is always good in life. But as I told you, I maybe my personality is a little different. I don't do that. I stay low profile when competitions come. So, but say if I start getting time over a period, then I will definitely try to share my work on different platforms.
Right.
So, my achievement is, I said, I'm a trained naturalist. So that is a big achievement in life. And that gave me a lot of things in my life, wildlife-wise also, otherwise also. A lot of learning. See, if you know wildlife, nature, photography helps a lot. Naturalist training was one of the best trainings I had in my life.
Wonderful. Are you part of any photography communities, you know, any clubs or anything?
As I said, we usually go as a family. And then I have a small group of very, very like-minded friends. And they are common friends to you and me also, if you know. We have a small group called as Wildlife Action Photography. Okay, so this group, and then this group has its face on Facebook also. It has a group on Facebook also, where we share our work. And this group, we always try to, this is a group where we arrange our meetings. We meet maybe once in a while. Now that we have not been able to meet, we met on Zoom. We arrange post-processing classes. We share our work. This group, we went to Kenya. We went to Sri Lanka. We went to Bhutan. We went to Ecuador. We went to Botswana. So we have a close-knit, like-minded, and a lot of doctors are there in that group. And there are people from all the different professions, and some very well-known people like Anant Murthy, Jitendra Govindani, and a lot of other people, Jinesh Malleshwari. They are all there, and they are all very well. They are quite very known in their field for photography, and they all come. We all go together. We teach each other. We learn and we enjoy.
Wonderful. So, is that group open for anybody to join, as such?
They can join on Facebook.
Okay.
Initially, once they join, then we announce wherever we are going or doing anything. We had a lot of exhibitions. We had a lot of other activities. We had competition recently on that. And then we also conduct trips. So it's all announced on the Facebook. And then once that is done, and once they join our group, then we meet in person. We arrange group meetings, and then we go together. So it is always there on that. The advertisement or the information you want to get about the group will come through Facebook.
Okay. Can you, for the benefit of our viewers, just mention the group name again?
It's Wildlife Action Photography. It's called as VAP. V-A-P.
Same VAP that the contest happened last month.
Yeah, last month the contest happened. So it keeps happening on this group. And okay. we have a huge participation in that. And there's a huge number of members in that. It's one of the, I think, second or third group which has that big membership, wildlife group, I'm saying, which has that big membership when it comes to Facebook in India.
Okay, wonderful. So I'm sure a lot of people, aspiring photographers, would want to join and learn as well.
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot of learning going at no unnecessary cost.
Wonderful. Okay, so next question for you, Sanjeev, is do you receive critics for your work as well? And how do you handle them? Especially, I think a lot of aspiring photographers want to know, as to how to handle critics, because like you said some time back, everybody likes appreciation. But what about criticism and feedback?
Criticism, if nobody gives, you use the word criticism, I will use the word feedback.
Correct.
Now, the feedbacks can be pleasing, the feedbacks can be learning. You don't call them negative feedbacks. You always call them learning feedbacks. And this is how you should take it. Unfortunately or fortunately, since I am in a low profile, usually I never got too many criticisms, bad criticisms particularly. So I always got learning feedbacks. So whenever I get, the first thing always you should remember is the photo I click is for me. I should like it first. Maybe a lot of people may not like. There are some photographs which I really like so much, but a lot of people don't like. There's a wolf. I have got wolf are very rare. I have a beautiful photograph of wolf. If I post it, I'm sure I'm not going to get any likes or anything. But that is very special for me. So each photo is special for you. May not be special for a lot of other people. They may not like it. They may give you a feedback which is not pleasing to you. But then take it positively. First thing is you should like it. Second thing is you get any feedback, please take it and try to understand and take it positively and improve on that. That is very important. Don't use the word critic. And then there are some people who always want to be in limelight by criticizing you. That is their job. Let them do it.
Right.
Let them do it. You should not waste time on that. You should not get depressed because of that. If you think you are doing a good work which is keeping you happy, please go ahead and keep doing it. This is my advice. Never, never, ever get drowned into that bucket of criticism. Don't do that.
Absolutely. And I think you touched on a very important point also, Sanjeev, because a lot of people come back and say, hey, this is so beautiful work, but you know, nobody likes it, you know. But then I think it's very critical, and I am also a very firm believer of that, that you should always click for yourself first, you know, irrespective of whether your family likes it, friends like it or not. And then, you know, ask opinion. There's no harm in, you know, for people, you know, everybody's
creative. Because, but when we were sitting in the group and we were discussing, there are some photographs which were literally rejected, not even accepted. In Indian competitions and in international salons, they won gold. So, very close friend of mine. I have some very good photographers who are very good friends of mine, and a lot of learning goes through them. They got international award, a gold medal on those which were rejected in India. So, there's nothing like that. The judge's opinion here may be different from the judge's opinion overseas. The way they look at it is different than the way we look at it. If I like my photograph and I feel I'm happy with it, we be happy with it.
Absolutely. And I think I participate myself, you know, as a photographer in a lot of salons. And I can tell you this, that, you know, everybody who sees your picture sees it in a different perspective. Everybody's judgment is different. So there's nothing wrong to say that, you know, I won here, I lost there. You know, it's fine. It's perfectly fine. You know, because I think the number of entries that come in every competition is different. So, you know, the level of...
massive. And what is happening is there are so many platforms open off late. Right. I'm not criticizing or I'm not giving a negative feedback, but I have seen some wildlife photography judges or wedding photographers. So it happens sometimes. Their way of looking into the things is a little different. Sometimes the portrait photographer is judging your wildlife action. So it happens. So there are, but no, majority of the good bodies, photography bodies are doing it very genuinely. And the quality of the photographs off late, whether it's national or international, I will talk about national, they are awesome. They are just unbeatable. They are too good. There's so much of learning from there. If you don't get an award, then always go and see who got the first, who got the second. Look into it and try to reach to that level. It is very important. The standards are going high and high every year.
Right. And I think there's nothing wrong in getting inspired from, you know, somebody else, you know, who did well.
Yes. You know, it's always like that.
Always helps kind of.
He may be a newcomer. He may be too junior to you, but everybody teaches us. And as I said, in medical college, when I was teaching, every day one postgraduate student will come and teach me something and go. We always take it very positively. So similarly in wildlife also, you should not take it to your ego. Your juniors will teach you more than your seniors will teach you. This is always there. So you should always learn from everybody. A guide knows more than, a guide sitting next to you in Jeep knows much, much more than you when... Although you think that you have come 10 times to this park, but he has been in that park for more than thousands of times. So we have to respect everybody. And that is how, once you start respecting them, talking to them, if there is a photographer who has won, rather than not talking to him in ego, is always better to go to him, learn something from him, talk to him, appreciate his work. You will come back with some new knowledge. That should always be your idea of photography, particularly wildlife photography.
Right. I think that's very important. So next question, Sanjeev, is, you know, since we all know, you know, the digital world, you know, the technology is blooming so much, you know,
yeah.
What do you think is the scope of photography? You know, because the technology is in every aspect today.
We know technology is improving, and that is why the standard of photographs is going up. Quality. Now we don't have to concentrate too much on settings, this, that. Your camera almost takes care, it tracks the animal. Nowadays, the new generation cameras are tracking the eye as well. So we concentrate more on catching the action, freezing the action, compositions. So we deal with all those things, and the improvement in digital technology is allowing us to experiment more. So, and we come out with some good photographs because of the good cameras that we have got. The same thing would not have been possible with some great photographs where earlier they have done that. I really sometimes get amazed with the work they have done with those old cameras. So, we have huge liberty. So, once this is improving, quality of photographs is improving. Since we have a lot of social media, we have other platforms, a lot of things we learn through those platforms. A lot of cameras are easily available now, which were not available a few years back. All the lenses, you have a variety of cameras for all budgets. You have a variety of lenses for all budgets. For all your needs, you have everything. You have accessories which are available at all different prices. right from tripods to gimbal heads. You have variety of them. You don't have to spend too much. If you use it logically, you can come out with some excellent. So that is what is the advantage of this for this generation. They have everything available very easily at very manageable cost, number one. And number two, the new generation, their mentality has changed. They are spending, they are earning also. So a lot of things have changed over a period of time when I see this purchasing capacity improvement going into wild, going into safaris, which are little expensive, going overseas. I've seen people who save money to do a trip. So mentalities are changing now. Digital world has helped a lot in changing this mentality.
Wow. Okay. Wonderful. And I think you spoke about most of the hardware based equipments, but I think on the technology in the software level as well has tremendously changed.
Software has tremendously changed. Right. Forget you. First, when you go, you click your lens software. There's so much of updates that happen on your lens software. Earlier, we never used to have anything like that. Once you take a lens, till you sell it, you never update any software on your lens. Now we have to go and update our lens softwares. Camera softwares we knew those days. Nowadays, so you automatically, you can do it at your home in cameras. So everything is updated. Now softwares for post-processing have come so nice ones. So post-processing softwares, every day, there's so much of artificial intelligence coming in a post-processing software. Everything is improving. So we should give the best, the engineers are giving us the best of their technology to help us. So it is on our part, we should give them the best wildlife photographs.
Wonderful.
We should reciprocate.
Absolutely. And I think the people who will embrace technology, you know, will be the forefront.
Yes, you have to update. For me, I have to update on medical knowledge. I have to update on this. If you don't update, you're gone. Whether you're a doctor or a photographer or an engineer or anybody.
Right.
Everybody needs to get updated. We are living in a world where we have to get updated.
Absolutely.
That is an advantage for us also, for everybody.
Right. So my next question, Sanjeev, would be, you know, are there any future plans with respect to photography? I know that you said, you plan things, but then anything else?
I have a huge long list of, I have a wish list, a bucket list, I would say is a huge bucket list. I don't think I will be able to cover them in the one life, but I will try to do as much as possible. That is my whenever given a choice. Now, COVID had stopped me from going to a lot of places. Otherwise, I would have finished my Costa Rica and I would have been back. February, I would have done my Ladakh and I would have been back. So I'm missing all those days, but that is how it is. We have to face everything and I have to be here since the pandemic is here. I'm not going anywhere because my services are needed. So we have to balance a lot of things in life. But I have a very long list of things to do in India, outside India. And since I said I have a lot of lesser animals, which are very difficult to find and shoot. So that is one of my bucket list to do. Then, as I said, I will keep updating my knowledge and my gadgets also. So every time you have to. You start using and within 2 or 3 years, it's like your mobile phone. A new technology, a better version comes. And when you go in wildlife, you get that few seconds to shoot and you want the best thing to be in your hand. So you always would love to have a best gadget in your hand. Right. I want to update them. Then if time permits over a period of time, I will try to participate in competitions, salons, and I will try to exhibit my work. I'll arrange some exhibitions and all is achievable. And only it is a matter of management of time. I should be able to do it over a period of time.
Wonderful. We hope to see that wish list fulfilled in this lifetime itself, Sanjeev.
Yeah. All wishes will definitely, all may not come true, but a good number should come true.
We should target for everything to come true, but yeah, I mean, something or may not happen.
Amen.
For sure. I'm sure that, if you're so clear that you want to do it, I'm sure it will happen.
Should happen, yeah. I will give a try. I will always give a try.
Wonderful. My next question, Sanjeev, is do you publish your work on, any social media platforms? If yes, for the benefit of all the aspiring photographers, can you tell us how they can follow you?
Yeah, I know that. But I always told you, I don't exhibit my work much. I stay on a low profile. I don't go for too many competitions. But one big learning in my life has been India Nature Watch. INW, what we call, that was the first body where we started sharing our photographs, and that was the learning and making a network. I have a huge number of friends through India Nature Watch, and they are beautiful and very talented photographers, and their work is amazing. I learned a lot from that. All the aspiring photographers should go to India Nature Watch website, and they should log in, and you should see the work people are doing. They can also put their work, and they can get all the feedbacks like you do it in your Facebook. Other place, I normally, sometimes when I get time, I would, sitting in the hospital or at home when I get time, it's easy to put your work on Facebook and Instagram. So that is one place where I put, and even putting on Facebook, as I said, our wildlife action photography group, there I post, and I get a lot of feedbacks, and I learn a lot. I see other people's work. The main thing why you need to connect on these is, more than posting your work, you see other people doing it and learn a lot from them. So that is also, it's a two-way thing. So I do it on social media. In general, I don't exhibit it too much, but everybody should see two places right now. One is India Nature Watch, and other is the Wildlife Action Photography Group on Facebook.
Wonderful. So for the benefit of our aspiring photographers, maybe you can list down your Instagram handle for them to follow you.
It's Sanjeev Managoli. That's all.
So
I don't have any, a lot of people have fancy names on Instagram. It's so difficult to recognize them. And I don't know, really, they are so much talented, where they get those names from. My name is very simple, SanjeevManA. There's MANAGOLI. So Sanjeev Managoli is what is my Instagram handle, and they can always visit my handle and see my work.
Wonderful. So it's your first name, last name, without any space. So that's
without any space, without any space. Yes.
Okay, wonderful. So a sub question to that is, we understand that you may not be doing much or keeping low profile on social media, but do you think it is important for people to use social media platforms, especially photographers, to highlight their work?
Yes, definitely. They should be using it. See, we have been using social media for wrong reasons.
Right. Okay.
Showcase your work. Get right. Feedback.
Right.
See other people's work. Try to learn something from them. Give them a feedback. So this is the right way of using a social media, rather than posting something that brings displeasure to the community. Don't do all those things. Isn't it? What do you say?
Right.
We should use the social. It's a two-edged sword. You can use it very, very nicely also. And that is what our group has been doing. We have been doing some wonderful work on Facebook. So INW, as I said, there's so much to learn from that. Once the people who first time go and see that site, they will understand what I'm talking about. There's so much to learn without anything bad what a social media has on it. So go for the positive things, please. The social media is one of the best ways to showcase your work, understand and learn.
Right. Wonderful. My last question for you, Sanjeev, is, have you heard about Honeycomb Creative Support, PhotoStop, the printing brand of Honeycomb?
Definitely, definitely. Being in Bangalore, I think everybody knows about Honeycomb. It was a few years back, I think around 4 years back, when I got in touch with their team, Nafil sir and Shri Kumar. They are one of the, that was the beginning of Honeycomb, when they, around 5 years back, when they were still in, not very famous. That is the time when we met them. And through our group, what I said, Wildlife Action Photography, Anant Kumar, Jinish and Jitendra Govindani, we came as a team, and we worked together to get a few exhibitions done. And that was a big success. Now, WAP is famous. Honeycomb is also famous. So Honeycomb, everybody knows, and they have some great work. They have helped us a lot in putting our exhibitions for our group. Two exhibitions we did in Bangalore with the, I was a volunteer for our group those days, and one was in Chitrakala Parishad, the other was in the campus of Honeycomb itself. So we did our exhibition in that only, and then we took Honeycomb all the way to Hyderabad, and we have a team of WAP in Hyderabad where we showcased our Kenya trip photography, the WAP Kenya. They have been amazing people, very helpful and quality work. The finishing is amazingly outstanding. And then in addition to this, we always meet when we are in NIF and Nature in Focus. Every year we have the conference, and they are there. They are there to support NIF. They are there to support the photographers. And all the prints that are put on NIF is their work. And it's really amazing. I have been following their work for last 4 years in NIF, and it has been amazing.
Absolutely. And I think I vouch for that as well, Sanjeev, because like you rightly said, I have been you know, as a customer of Honeycomb for the last 5 odd years, although the company is a 13-year-old company, you know,
yeah.
But then, the prints, even I did my solo exhibitions last year, two of them. So, you know, mm-hmm. The response that I've got from people who have either bought my prints or have come to my exhibition, you know, they, some of them were even surprised to know that you can print on canvas. So, you know, that's the level of...
They have some amazing stuff there. And they have, if I don't know if viewers should be... you have any link you just share with our viewers. And the reason is they have so much of variety.
Absolutely.
When I say variety, it means you will get the good quality at a budget price. You'll get good quality on canvas. Canvas is expensive. Canvas printing is expensive. Paper printing is not that expensive. So they see that. They actually see that they give you every quality within your budget. They will give you every print within your budget, which will be high quality. So that I can assure you about Honeycomb. I know them from quite a few years. Right. And that is one part of the professionalism. But as a person, these two people are gem of a person.
Right.
That is the biggest advantage of going to these people. Once you go there, you are stuck to them. You cannot go anywhere else.
So that's really good to hear, Sanjeev. Thank you very much.
Yeah, most nice welcome.
One last thing before we conclude. I'm sure you are excited to talk about the upcoming webinar that you are doing, you know, in collaboration with Honeycomb. So do you want to just mention that as a passing?
Yeah. All the viewers, I'm really honored that Honeycomb and Mithun will be interviewing me. Honeycomb has invited me to showcase some of my work. That will be on 16th August at 7 p.m. It will be, I invite you all to attend it. I will share my journey and I will learn something from you. I will give my tips, whatever I learned from other people. So it will be fun. Please join me next to next Sunday, that is 16th at 7 p.m.
Yeah, and I can assure you viewers that, you know, it is going to be very interesting because, you know, I had a discussion with Sanjeev just yesterday on his thought process. You know, you'll be surprised to see what he's going to showcase. So please do not miss, you know, Sunday, August 16th.
Let us not give very high hopes, but we will enjoy.
No, you're trying to be a modest and humble Dr. Sanjeev, but...
You're modest now. Thank you so much for that.
Wonderful. So nice talking to you, Sanjeev. That's absolutely
you,
great. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Mithun. Thank you, Honeycomb, for giving me this opportunity. Very big thanks to you all.
No problem.
See you then.
See you then. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.